100 years ago today in Kenya that a graduate from the University of Saskatchewan in 1912 stood before 3,000 Kikuyu warriors and challenged them, invited them to become protectors and planters of trees. In the language of the Kikuyu, it was Watu Wamiti, or men of the trees. This man, Richard St. Barbe Baker, had gone there in 1922 after graduating from the university here and homesteading near Beaver Creek. He had gone back to England, served in World War I, and then studied forestry at Cambridge, and this was his first job, you know, his first long-term job, and with the Colonial Service. At that time, of course, Kenya was a British colony. So he found himself in Kenya and did a couple of shorter assignments, and then ended up at this station north of Nairobi called the Treeless Place. And the Kikuyu people were nomadic farmers. They migrated from farther north. They weren't traditional forest dwellers. And their approach to farming was slash and burn, which is a tropical approach because tropical soils don't maintain their fertility very long, so you move on to a new patch of soil. He became convinced that people needed to learn how to care for the trees and replant trees, so he introduced the idea of intercropping and like planting trees between corn and yams and groundnuts and so on, so that there would be a perpetual forest renewed. So in order to work with the people, he developed what we would now call social forestry. It had a patronizing aspect. Like you could say, you know, he was part of the Colonial Service, but he didn't really fit most of the colonial values. He believed in the equality of people. He'd worked with indigenous people and met with them when he homesteaded near Beaver Creek. And he talks about Charlie Eagle, a man that he met at that time. And the same with Kikuyu. He befriended them. He got to know their tribal customs. He spoke a language, Swahili, which was close to their language. He learned it on the boat on the way there. And he thought, if I adopted their custom, which was dancing before major events, whether it was the planting of crops or harvesting of crops or for marriages and ceremonies, they started everything with a dance. So he took the risk of organizing this dance of the trees. This inspiration came to me one night when he was thinking about it. He approached the elders and the chiefs, and they came on board. And then his next job was to convince the chief of the dancers, Fongo. And so that began, and then he invited all these young Morans, as they're called, young warriors, to his camp. And he had kind of a contest for best, you know, bullock and so on. So to his surprise, some 3,000 young warriors showed up at this dance of the trees, and they were camped there, and they were eager to get going with the dance, and there was another 2,000 people camped nearby as onlookers. And so St. Barbe got up to give his approach to basically say, you know, you've been doing this kind of agriculture, but it's not sustainable, and you need to become planters of trees, protectors of trees. And so he proposed this idea of a kind of a, I guess you'd call it a secret society in a certain sense. So this Watu Wamiti, and so some several hundred of the warriors got up to join this, and they were kind of initiated into this secret society. They had a handshake, special handshake, and a password to Ahomwe, which means all together, working together. And they even had colors, and initially the colors were green and white, the colors of the U of S. But for him, the white stood for purity of heart and the green for the trees and forests. So so he was starting to develop tree nurseries, and you know, these people were involved in planting trees. So the pledge was to plant 10 trees each year, protect trees everywhere, and do a good deed each day. So that was the beginning of what at that time was called the Men of the Trees. Now, a year later, St. Barbe was sacked because he stood between a superior with a riding crop and a black worker, a Kikuyu worker, and St. Barbe took the blow. And that kind of insubordination wasn't accepted in the colonial service at that time. So he was sent packing back to England. So in 1924, back in England, he registered this organization, the Men of the Trees. But soon after that, he was back in Nigeria. He actually had to regain, by special roundabout ways, intake back into the colonial service. He ended up back in Nigeria. And there again, working, he developed some innovative tree farms, kind of incorporating agroforestry and permaculture and cooperatives. And then when he toured the country in northern Nigeria, he saw the fact of tribal people moving farther south as the desert lands started to be deforested. And that was when he really got a sense of the effect of forests on climate. He had really noticed the microclimatic effects of forest when he was doing these tree farms and studying the ecology of the forests. And it was while in Kenya, he also, during that period, he helped organize and attended the first World Congress, Forestry Congress in Rome. And there he met a lot of contacts with foresters around the world. And so it was there in Nigeria, with that more global perspective, that he got at that conference, and this sense that the forests of Africa needed to be protected, and that if they weren't, this desertification would continue, and his foresight has proved true, unfortunately. So, Paul Hanley, in his book, The Biography, wrote, "At this point in his service in Nigeria, he began to see himself as a kind of global tree missionary, with a mission to educate the world to save itself from catastrophe. Africa was a microcosm. The world is becoming a desert. Only tree cover could hold and reverse the trend. And it was his job to organize a global campaign." St. Barbe came from a family that had a lot of swashbucklers. His great-great-grandfather had been an explorer in Africa and sailed around the world. And his uncle had come to Canada and things like that. So he kind of fell into this kind of a family mythology, you know, like we have a role to play. His father had been a missionary, had a kind of a, even on their farm, which was a tree nursery, he had a mission hall, and so people would come there to study, but he was also visited by people of other religions. His father was very open-minded, so he had a global perspective from back then. But anyway, after in Nigeria in 1928, late 28, he was very ill with malaria and had to go back to England. Then it came 1929, and Richard Allenby, who was commissioner for Palestine, had heard of St. Barbe's work and invited him to come there to help with tree planting and bringing together warring factions from different religious groups there. And so St. Barbe took the challenge. He came there and established a branch of the Men of the Trees. And he did that in a very bold way by kind of establishing the whole charter for the organization and naming the heads of these various religious groups as patrons. And he had this all written up, and then he had to invite them in this hall where there was curtains. And then when the curtains were open, they found themselves in the same room, and they were too embarrassed to leave. So he got this on board, and it met with some success in his tree planting endeavors in Palestine. And then he also participated in a Jewish tree planting festival, and he really cottoned on to the social aspect of forestry there, like children and families marching and carrying trees to plant new neighborhoods in Tel Aviv. So 1929, of course, being the market crash, there were no more jobs in the colonial service, and so it kind of freed him to set out on a journey. And he decided to come to USA, where he had met many contacts at this World Forestry Congress. He arrived in New York with 5 pounds in his pocket, And that was kind of his style. He lived kind of like a raven. He lived on serendipity. He just trusted that the right people and the right thing would happen. And that's exactly what happened in New York. He met a friend that he knew in Africa, and his friend took him to a kind of a fancy club. And then at this club, a book editor overheard St. Barbe talking about Africa and approached the table and said, if you can write as well as you can speak, write me a book. And so St. Barbe holed up, got an advance, holed up in a hotel, and wrote his first book in 30 days. And thereafter set out on a grand tour of the USA doing speaking engagements, and ending up visiting the Redwoods, where he totally fell in love with this magnificent forest. So his life kind of goes on from there. During the 30s, he came back to USA every year, not 1931, but after Redwoods' first time, he went on to Australia, New Zealand, and did the same thing. He would do cold calls to pick newspapers and radio stations. And then back in USA in 1932, he did a cold call to Franklin Delano Roosevelt's secretary. FDR was running for president, and FDR was known for his love of trees and had initiated some forestry work in New York State, where he had been governor. And so St. Barbe visited him, kind of praised his work with trees, and talked up this idea of a major tree planting endeavor to put people back to work. And of course, when FDR was inaugurated in 1933, that was one of the first bills he passed and established the Civilian Conservation Corps. And as soon as the inauguration, St. Barbe was on a boat again. They came to Washington and kind of had a first row seat to the development of this massive tree planting program. And he came back to the Redwoods every year after that during the 30s. He started fundraising campaigns in England for the Save the Redwoods campaign. And he established himself more in England as well with the Men of the Trees, and by 1938 there were over 5,000 members in over 108 countries. And then of course the World War II, he did sort of a tree pruning business in London. And then after the war, his worldly perspective grew again, and he set out on tours. He wrote a book called Green Glory, Forests of the World, so he did a whole overview of all the forests of the world. And then in the 1950s, he decided that the Sahara Desert had been partly caused by over-exploitation, wheat farming even during the Roman Empire, and that he wanted to see this firsthand for himself. So he planned this expedition across the Sahara from London to Kenya, and they found evidence of petrified wood and remnant forest pieces, and he became firmly entrenched with the idea that the Sahara could be reclaimed with massive shelter belt plantings. And that became his grand ambition during the 50s. And then in the 1960s, he was already in his 70s, he visited all the countries around the Sahara to try to convince them of this plan. He kind of saw it as a plan that would unite East and West if all the countries of the world kind of got together with this major mega project. But of course, it was the Cold War, and he was a visionary ahead of his time, and this wasn't taken up. But St. Barbe was not deterred. He kept continued on traveling around the world. And so the story takes up to 1971, when he came here to receive an honorary doctorate from the U of S. And he set up a little prize at the university called the Men of the Trees Prize. And I was awarded that prize in the spring of 1982. I was a graduate in plant ecology. And I was intrigued by his name, intrigued by the prize. So I wrote a letter to him in England and saying I might be traveling to England. I was planning to travel around the world myself. And so he didn't get the letter the first time. It was returned to me. I found a new address, but I didn't change the letter, because by that time I'd planned to go to Australia first. But anyway, he finally got the letter, and I was in Australia already, but he phoned my mom. I'd put the farm as my, up in Prince Albert, I grew up in the farm, and I put my mom's name, and that is my return address. And he phoned the farm and said, you know, if you get, you know, come to England, I'll, you know, please look me up. And so I had this on my back pocket, I guess, but I was touring Australia for a year and then came overland from Australia to England. And it was almost 2 years later then that I arrived in London in 1974. And I phoned them up from London and I got the train out to Guildford and walked up to this estate where he was staying with another gentleman. He had married, a second marriage, he'd married a sheep rancher in New Zealand. And so he spent part of the year in New Zealand and the rest of the year in England. He was no longer leader of the Men of the Trees, but he was still very involved with promotion. And so I arrived at the door and he put his arm around me and said, come in, my dear boy. And he started telling me these stories about his life. And I was blown away. I couldn't believe them, in fact. And then he was also telling me he was learning Chinese because he wanted to go to the China and cross the Gobi Desert on horseback to survey it for reforestation. And who do you meet that has that kind of vision? And you know, I was a young graduate of the agriculture and had kind of a very materialistic mindset, which I was trying to get outside of by my travels. But I still wasn't ready for this. But anyway, St. Barbe latched on to me and we kept in touch. And every time he came back to Canada, he somehow found me, not by prearrangement. I was working at the U of S and he showed up and he'd always go to the president's office because of his honorary doctorate, and he developed a relationship with Dr. Spinks, who was no longer president, but befriended. And So the university office got in touch with me and we met up, and the next day I was leaving for the Yukon. I came back in the fall and he'd had a book on my desk. I was moving to Toronto due to my master's. And then when I was in Toronto, finished my master's, I volunteered to speak at a health conference of all things. And there was St. Barbe on the agenda speaking about trees and longevity. And then again in 1981, the late 1981, maybe early 1982, he wrote me from New Zealand and said, this time, would I meet him in Saskatoon? So he'd been around the world three times in the time since I met him. He got a postcard from Brazil and letters from New Zealand and so on. And this time he wanted to meet at the U of S and convince the university to set up a chair in deep ecology. I dedicated my thesis that I'd written on that subject to St. Barbe. And so he was really taken by this idea, which is something that he had practiced. Like, if we understand our interrelationship with all of nature, then we have to totally live from that ethic, which he did. So he arrived. He was delayed, actually. He'd been in the Redwoods for a dedication of World Heritage sake. He was ill. He was delayed. My flight from Toronto to Saskatoon was non-refundable. So there I was still in Toronto, and then I got a postcard that he would be arriving in early June. I had a dream about him, and in the dream it became clear to me that I needed to see him, so I came. The Baha'i community in Saskatoon, St. Barbe had studied religious studies here at the U of S, and then he encountered the Baha'i faith in the 1920s, and that really fit with his kind of global perspective, because it's very open to the unity of all faiths. And so the Baha'i community arranges tree planting at the U of S by the Diefenbaker Center, and we arrived there to plant this tree, and it was raining. David and I thought we should cancel. He said no. We arrived there around 1 o'clock, just before 1 o'clock. The sun came out, planted the tree. It's a beautiful ceremony. We gathered around the tree and he led us in. He'd been in a wheelchair. We had to carry him down the stairs in a wheelchair, but he got up from the wheelchair and he led us in this chant that he developed, our motto for a group that he developed called Children of the Green Earth. And it goes like this: from our hearts, with our hands, for the earth, all the world together. And I think that's in the film as well. So we took him back, the rain started again, took him back to where he was staying, and 4 days later, when he was going to go on to Toronto with me to stay at a place for respite, he died, and was buried here in Saskatoon. So it's kind of interesting that he came here in 1909, homesteaded under Beaver Creek, attended the U of S, considered it his alma mater, and then reconnected in the 1970s and returned here and died here, and then the city had named this Afforestation area after him, but he didn't know that, or we would have visited that time in the 1980s, because that was named in 79. And so here we are. The Afforestation area is now championed by Julia and the Friends of the Afforestation area, and getting some traction with protection with the city. We got a big grant to help put barriers to illegal entry and dumping of waste. And so this film is about, starts with the Afforestation area, but really goes into the background of St. Barbe and his life story, and then a lot of tributes from people that he inspired. He had a way with people, and like he just connected with people like me and inspired them with his ideas, and he kept in touch with them and kept encouraging people, and that's why so many people joined the Men of the Trees. And we got a little letter from the International Tree Foundation, that's now the name of the Men of the Trees, and it said, it says, St. Barbe was ahead of his time in advocating for trees in the natural world. He practiced permaculture and agroecology before they were officially invented, and warned of the horrific impact of deforestation before the science caught up. Although not as well known as modern environmentalists like Attenborough, St. Barbe left a lasting legacy. Some estimates put 25 billion trees worldwide were planted by his influence. Many of the ITF supporters today were inspired to join us after meeting St. Barbe in person. Some have been generously planting trees through ITF for more than 50 years. Such was the deep impact of our founder. Today, St. Barbe's legacy lives on. His influence goes deep and stands tall. And they talk a little bit about their foundation, which is headquartered in England, but has membership in, I think, 13 African countries, and does a lot of work in Africa along the lines that he did there in social forestry and agroforestry.